Welcome all in one and one and all to the defense powered by Own 3D TV and supported by Razer. I'll be your host, Toby Wan Kenobi, for what is now our third try at this. We are here for Wild Honey Badgers. They'll be going up against Global Domination Time. It is the boys from Sweden with a little bit of Danish salted over the top going up against the guys from America. Let's jump ourselves straight into the game before I break anything else. And we'll actually have a look at our bans and picks to see how we're going. And yes, for the guys, yes, I am alone in the studio, just for trolling. You're saying that up in the IC. I'm alone here, man, on the weekend. It's just me and you. We have some personal time. This is our time when we get to know each other on like a level, like beyond that you can achieve over the internet. It's a level called commentating. Great to have you guys here. All right, so let's have a look at our bans and picks so far. So far in our banning sage, we have Prophet as well as Earthshaker taken out. GTT have removed out Broodmother and Omni Knight. So let's take out our big, big pushes as well as counter heroes to team fights. I'm talking as Omni Knight as a counter hero to all team fights. Like, hey, we're going to kill him. Oh, he's got Repel and a heal. Oh, hang on. No, we're not going to kill him. Damn it. And Earthshaker with his awesome ultimate. In the end, though, we get two big heroes, and Nightstalker as well as Lich. Getting picked up by the Radiant. Now, the first pick did actually go to the Dire, and they instantly picked up Anti-Mage. Radiant will be very, very happy, the Wild Honey Badgers, for the fact they actually picked up the Nightstalker. Nightstalker, if he gets that Silent Strike, will shut down Anti-Mage, so Anti-Mage might think about a Linker Sphere just to ensure that he can't get completely dominated. Either that, or just save your time, buy a Battle Fury, buy a Manta, buy a Heart, and buy everything else, especially basically makes Anti-Mage completely unstoppable. Lich also coming up for the Radiant side, so support whatever lane you actually need it to be, not to mention the big ultimate, if they get it off right. It's going to be hard to actually do so, considering the VS swap will be there, as well as the Anti-Mage Blink, Ancient Apparition. It'll be a little bit easy to actually kill, but his ultimate as well will really devastate during those big team fights. Tide Hunter. And we do have Tidehunter coming up too. And for CCCCK, who actually asked if GDT is actually an ex-Hon team, no, they're not. They're actually a Dota 1 team. They always have been, always probably will be as well. They've been around since the dawn of Dota 1. Well, actually not that long, actually. Hey, drink twice. Yeah, GDT have actually always played Dota 1. Through Dotalicious, through many, many different clients. They've tried to compete in leagues here and there. They're all friends. All complete friends. In fact, there's actually a wife and husband combination in this team as well. That is Princess and Taku. They are actually married, got married about a year ago. So yeah, they're a very, very close-knit team. I'm going to have a drinks break. Now, they're a very, very closely tied in together team. They're going to have to be as well to actually get past WHB. WHB, one of those teams which train together, they live together, they sleep together, except all in a completely platonic way. who knows, at DreamHack they might do that. Witch Doctor as our ban for the Radiant. Surprising to see Witch Doctor being banned out, especially considering Radiant, WHB have actually really enjoyed picking him. Matrim has played him a couple of times over the recent times. Jesus, a mage bane. Jeebus! Tidehunter. But yeah, Tidehunter, fantastic hero when it comes to team fights. Really, really great hero. Not to mention early on the game, like, if he's used to his effectiveness, then you can have some good gushes, and you might be able to make something of it. But you need to have extra stunners to go with. And that's something which I'm noticing is really missing from the Radiant side. Like, Nightstalker has a slow and silence. Lich has a slow and deny. He does have a stun, but it's only in the first hit of his ultimate. After he keeps bouncing around, there's not that mini stun. It's just with that first initial hit of the ultimate. And then Tidehunter has a gush, and then he has to get to level 6 as well before he gets his big AoE stun. So as far as the rating go, we might look at a hero like Lion, or look towards another hero that's actually got some good, decent stuns or disables, because they really need it. More than likely, I'm looking at Windrunner as part of their lineup, but the Dire will also want that as well. So maybe we'll see what's going to go on. The Dire banning out the big high carry, so Spectre as well as Weaver taken out. I hardly doubt that Dire will actually go for that. I'm looking more towards a Faceless Void for them. If they want to go the two big melee high carries, either that or even Sniper. Sniper wouldn't be a bad option. He does actually have that that headshot ability, which has a mini stun attached to it. So if he needs to actually try and stun anybody, there'll be the Shackles, and if he does actually have to pop it too, it'll be very, very easy with the Assassination to pick off either Windrunner a little bit harder. But Eventual Spirit as well as Ancient Apparition should be easy enough. A Windrunner with that side lane, so Dyer will be able to run Windrunner either solo top or if they run the tri-lane bottom lane. More than likely, they'll want to run Anti-Mage on that top lane. Ventral Spirit and Ancient Apparition could go for a little bit of a roam together. Good combination to actually pop off the VS stun, as well as the Ancient Apparition Cold Feet. Can you actually upload the VODs if it's nice? A question from Arcadia. I can answer your question saying yes. VODs are uploaded at the end of every single day. They're always available, generally before midnight, depending when we actually finish. I go home, I upload them. Generally take about an hour or so per an hour, maybe hour and a half, depending how many VODs I actually do, and then the processing time for M3D TV. But you can check them all out. They update automatically on the joindota.com/VODs page. You can check them all out there. Just for you. Mirana comes up for the Radiant, so we do actually have ourselves a little bit of stun. Not a guaranteed stun. It's a good stun if it's long, but they're very, very hard to actually get without a setup stun. But that does give the Radiant their side lane hero, so Mirana might actually run down towards the bottom lane, and we might actually see a little bit more aggression on the top if we have Tide, and Beastmaster comes up from the die. So a very, very strong lineup here from GDT. They've got some good stuns that go through BKB as well, which is not really the way that Nightstalker is going to be played for the Radiant side, because Nightstalker is kind of like one of those heroes that will just pop up the Aghanim Scepter if he needs to. Obviously, Cinderin likes to play the Yules kind of thing, the extra movement speed, extra mana regen, especially early on. You get the Sobe Mask early on, then you get the Void Stone, then you get yourself the rest of it, which helps you build up towards the Yules. So it makes life a little bit easy for them. So I'm just wondering if GDT have done their homework on WHB and go, okay, they don't run BKB on Nightstalker. Generally, later on in the game, now think about it. And Pugna comes up for the Radiant. Now, Pugna's not a hero we've seen in a very, very long time. As far as being able to push back is good, but what's even better about it is the fact that if he drops that Nether Ward, Windrunner's Power Shot, Shackle Shot, Beastmaster's Axes, Beastmaster, even the Call of the Wild, his Roar ability, Ventral Spirit with Howls, Magic Missiles, Swaps, Ancient Apparition if he wants to cast Cold Feet. Who else have we actually got in this lineup? Anti-Mage, if he wants to blink, it will cause damage to actually be done to him. So a very, very nice pick up there to try and control these big team fights, which they knew they're already struggling for. Like, they got a stun that goes through BKB from the Beastmaster, VS great for positional as well as initiation, Ancient Apparition, such a boss, Windrunner, well, we know, we saw in our last game just how effective those Shackle Shots can actually be, and then Anti-Mage just jumping himself around inside the fight. Instead, they're going to try and shut them down, throw down that Nether Ward. You got the Tidehunter Ultimate, you got the Lich Ultimate as well. Then you got Nightstalker is going to be out there to actually disable down these heroes and try and pick them off, and we'll run for your DPS a little bit later. So that's the way they're going to try and run this. We're going to run Cinderin on the bottom lane. We might see again a solo Cinderin on the bottom lane playing as that Nightstalker. Karani will be playing as the Tidehunter heading in towards the mid lane. Also is going to be Pugna, who I'm going to probably pick to actually go solo mid. 30 seconds to battle. Which would be actually slightly surprising, because Cinderin is kind of like one of those guys, Beastmaster versus Nightstalker, who'd like to do that. They probably realize this is going to happen. Ventral Spirit's going to be supporting up Taku. Either that or he's going to keep on walking and plant a ward. But more than likely, Beastmaster might be forced to have some support, mainly early on in the piece. He is one of those heroes with his boar and with his hawk that life can be good, but he needs to get those axes level 1. That allows him to actually get those last hits, harass off a little bit. And then he can get the ball. There's our DD rune on the top lane, and it's going to be the Sea Badge who actually sees it. And Talez would like to stop him, but he's not going to be able to. So Pugna will have a little bit easier time getting those last hits. In the meantime, Matrim will be going up towards the top lane. He'll be up there with Pepe, so we'll have ourselves possibly a dual lane. It's interesting to see where Pepe actually... Oh, we've got a leap. He's just playing a ward. I thought, are we actually going to see like a solo Lich against a tri-lane? It's been a while since I've seen one of those guys. But here's our stunning icing combination, the VS as well as Ancient Apparition. And they'll give more than enough space for this Anti-Mage to actually get some farm. And there goes our ward throwing down, so just denying. Hold that XP off. And even just getting one of those last hits in there for the deny works very, very nicely. First blood will be on the bottom lane by the looks of it. There's that gush I was telling you about. Yeah, actually, he can be effective early on with those gushes. Even though his mana pool is very, very low, being a strength hero, he's always played as that support. And then later on in the game, he can be that carry, but he's mainly just used for that gush, the extra early on slow, and then the Ravage. He was reworked a couple of months ago, where his anger smash was actually something that used to be triggered by a percentage chance. It was kind of like Axis spins, but they changed it around so that you can actually activate it yourself. And then, of course, you have your Kraken shell on the top. So we'll watch this top lane combination going very, very closely. The AM versus Mirana combination. We were noticing just before that Lich was actually harassing as well as Mirana was trying to harass the anti-mage back off the front lines. This is basically only a mental thing. You've got to say Pepe is actually mistaking up one of those last hits for a moment. But it's more of a mental thing to try and hold anti-mage back. Just make him think that you're going to attack him, because those consumables can be passed from Ventral Spirit as well as Ancient Apparition. So we'll be fine. Hello, Invis Rune on top. Ventral Spirit grabs at Sea Badger. Saw that as well. They have a Radiant Ward on the high ground, so they know that's there, and yellow now gets revealed. Walked in a little bit too close, so Ventral Spirit gets to remain invisible. I'm just going to give Lich something to actually worry about. It doesn't give much for Pugna to worry about. He can always be fine just to cripify himself if people get in a little bit too close. Got to be careful not to actually get stunned and everything else, because then it's going to be massive amplify through the Ancient Apparition, as well as the Cripify. And now he's in too close. VS with the stun. Cold Feet as well. Easy chain off with the Axes. There's what the Cripify is telling you about. Stops the attack. But it will be Vengeful Spirit who gets the last hit when he comes out of the very level 1. So very, very low to Cripify. Bottom lane going again. So there's Nightstalker with the Silence and the Gush. Windrunner manages to actually pop that off. But she's still running very, very slow because of that double slow from the bottom lane. We'll be able to live through that. Taku in the meantime, gonna be really careful. That boar is slowing down Sea Badger. Viet's gonna get in closer. Halaterra will fly to Cripify, look for the blast. Brenner bring the boar back in a little bit closer, runs up high. There goes the stun. The boar is already slowing him down. Axis will fly as well, but Sea Badger will be fine. But it's Taku who's got no life, no consumables, and really wanted to get towards that bottle, is now gonna find himself 90 short. And we'll have to walk all the way back to the main base and then still send the courier out later. In the meantime, Way Too Sexy is on King of the Castle kind of thing. Sitting up on the higher ground. Not quite sure who he's actually waiting for to come back in. As we see counter wards going out from Taku, from Yellow, realizing that there was vision for that. So needed to actually get rid of that, so they can surprise that Pugna in mid if they need to. Or ensure they don't get surprised from the rear, from good positioning from Wild Honey Badgers. There's Taku back at base. As I said, he's just short. 600 gold is what it costs for a bottle. And Beastmaster loves that, especially where he's in the middle lane. He'll leave the Hawk just hovering over the top of a rune. Haste. And it means things like this don't happen, where Wild Honey Badgers pick up themselves a haste rune, run towards the mid, a little bit of harassment, run back, sacrifice as well, and then can basically sprint yourself to another lane. In the meantime, we actually see a lane swap up. So Taku heads up towards the top lane. He hasn't bought a bottle. He just bought a TP scroll to get himself up there. So now it's Taku versus Mirana and Lich. This is not what he wants to be part of. Not only is there the slow, his ball will be able to do nothing because it can be brought down by range. And now the mid is actually setting up. VS. Talez as well as Yellow want to go this. Anti-Mage wants to go as well. VS comes in close, is trying to bait them down off a little bit. Yellow's the timing is bad there. Well, hello, bit of a spike for the point. We seem to be okay now. In the meantime, too, no time's about to start. There's that urn already, which is what Cinderin actually had when he started up his last game and then just dominates all the lanes from there. It's the way Nightstalker works. Windrunner, try and get all those last hits in with a power shot. Seems to be doing a pretty decent job too, 14 for 1. But you just see that farm, 7-1, 1-2, 2-1, 9-0. And then you check out Wild Honey Badgers, 19-10, 20-10, 2-1 for the support. And that's actually more than likely, I'm just realizing some people are losing some life. There's always what Cinderin does, just before the night time, he walks back to the main base just to buy whatever he possibly can. Yes. But that's, for the Lich, it's more like probably 2-10 with the amount of sacrifice that's been happening, if not more. And then 1-2 for Tide and 27 for 12. So as far as money goes, you even check on the graph here. 1,500 is already the advantage. Invisibility. Windrunner very, very lucky to actually pick up that invis. There's no support there for Titan, but she'd be like, oh crap. And it'll be fine. Antimage pretty low. Taku's been pushed in towards the secret shop. It's the nighttime. Taku's stuck as well. There's nowhere he can run. Axis actually will make an area where he can actually run. But Ancient Apparition will not be there in time.
More than I could chew.
It's the silence. It's the slow. It's the damage that can keep on coming out from Pepe no matter where he goes. Even with that hawk up there and he knew where to move, it wasn't possible. He was forced to actually try and cut through the trees. And in the end, it didn't really happen. And towards the middle lane, Lich getting some levels. Lich and Tidehunter. I like that. Just a simple thing. Nightstalker's now roaming out. And this is why if you ever play against Wild Honey Badgers, make sure Nightstalker is in your ban pool. It has to be in your ban pool. Syndrom plays him. Maybe 50% of his time he actually plays anything. Yellow, silenced, and if they need to, they can throw an arrow, but they don't need to. He's already slowed. And Syndrome just swipes against the last tip. Also being the closest one, he could have even given that kill to Pepe just then and picked up the charge on the urn himself, which is all he really wants. Beastmaster wanted to come back down towards that top room. Could be rather difficult for them. Lich is still getting those levels up to level 5, almost level 6. And up comes Morana. This needs his Starfall damage down the creep wave, as well as do a little bit of collateral damage to the Vengeful Spirit. Unfortunately, he's damaged it to the point where it's almost impossible to get any form of last hit on that creep wave, including the Siege Wagon. So Pepe gets no farm from that wave whatsoever. So the Starfall was good for harassment, as well as bringing down the creep wave faster. Because the creep wave came in range of the tower, he basically got nothing.
Regeneration.
Dire's bottom tower. Still, that top lane can be pushed pretty easily. The only downside is, it's just like, the second you get there, you gotta deal with a stun from Mirana. It's gonna be hard to kill her. So you destroy your creep wave, at which point you have to tank the tower. You gotta slow from Lich, and you don't know when he's gonna pop level 6. You don't know how close he is. Speaking of Crowan, he's actually pretty close to the tier 1 tower. That's not going to help him. Negative urn charges on top. Gush is gone. Windrun, Shackle. Just a bit of a missed chain of stuns there. The Shackle shot wouldn't have latched him to anything. They need to actually try and link Syndrome as well as Tidehunter together. But the second they realize that Windrunner came in, arrow. Not enough mana for a Starfall. But not really needed. Mirana gets it. That's where the mana goes to. Anti-Mage just blinks in. Sucks the remainder of it dry. It's just this slow balance tip towards the Wild Honey Badgers. I don't need to overextend at all. In fact, Seabed is doing exactly what he needs to do to creepify. Put off the blast in range of the hero, in range of the tower, in range of the creeps. It damages everything. It's the reason why Pugna was such a massive pickup about 6 months ago, because people realized the game is transitioning to this push kind of strat. It's like, what do we do against a push kind of strat? We grab the guy whose big AoE blast, and whose AoE blast is already at level 4, damages towers and heroes, and you can amplify all the damage on top. It's just like, hell freaking yeah, Pugna is our man. He is the god. And it got to the point where he got taken out every single time. It's also great for last hitting. For people who love to try and get those denies, you actually see just there, maybe a little bit premature from Sea Badger. Realizing he's losing his creep wave, it's actually fair enough, but he's got to stick around and get these last hits. Anti-Mage pause in the game. Do we have a disconnection? Yeah, we lost Windrunner. So Windrunner's back at the main base. Looks like he must have been disconnected for at least a couple of seconds. To actually be back at the base and facing the well means you've been disconnected for... After you've been disconnected for about 5 seconds, the game will automatically take your hero back to the main base. Yeah, that tower at 14. It's that one last hit which T-Badger wants to hurl right now. In fact, it's actually right there. I can't zoom in on it. I can move up and down. It's that green dot. Is the hit flying in towards the tower. Wants to see Yellow trying to pull on the top lane. Hasn't got himself a double pull. It's just a standard pull. Just to buy a little bit of space for Anti-Mage. He's almost level 6. Well, we're Cindering up on that top lane. 10 minutes in. He's popped that night time as well. It's a great ability to actually use during the nighttime. A lot of people might not even think about that when you're Night Stalker. You think, hey, it's nighttime. I don't really need to do much more than that because it's nighttime. But if you actually pop your ultimate, it stops time from moving. So he's basically the timekeeper as well as the nightkeeper, if you want to call him that way. So if you actually pop your ultimate of Night Stalker during the nighttime, time stops and the nighttime is extended, so you have a longer period of time. And during the nighttime, as it's coming back again, especially during the first time, you want to pop it about once, and then you wait, you hold on to it during the daytime if you need it, and then the second you hit nighttime on the second phase, you just keep popping that nighttime. It extends it out. You can basically take the nighttime to being about 20, 25 minutes long for just one transition, and generally a transition, I think, goes for about 6 to 8 minutes. Just a bit of a reminder for people who are also tuning in that if you do actually, if you are experiencing lag issues, you need to actually change the quality of the part of the stream you're actually watching. Either that or just check your net connection. Of course, this stream is going out fine. We will be doing a bit of a check of what was actually happening today to make sure everything was fine. But yes, until that point, I do apologize for it. The VODs will, however, be available in full HD. They are recorded locally and uploaded by me a little bit later on in the night, as I'm just double-checking to make sure. Yes, the VOD worked. Always got to double-check it. XSplit's just one of those kind of little suckers. People actually have troubles where, well, I know I do, where it records. Where it actually records in, it only records audio. It doesn't actually record the video at the same time. So we're still just waiting for one of the players to actually come back. Syndrome's getting a little bit bored. It's like, any word from him? I had the same question, man. I had the same question. What's the GO? What is the GO? Also, in this meantime, we should probably have a bit of a chat. I've been asked by GJ to ask when the Star Qualifiers Championships are actually happening. They're actually already happening. We're going to be covering that from 9 a.m. tomorrow morning. You can see them all on the match ticker over at joindota.com. We've added all the matches that actually happened this morning, as well as the matches which will be coming up tomorrow. I'll let you know which ones are going to be covering that as well. Should be writing up a bit of a news post with the VODs from today, a bit of a summary of today. So you'll be able to check that out when, basically after I've had a couple of moments to just chill and relax. So about 5 minutes I'm going to allow for that, and then get straight into all of that. But you'll be able to check out a lot of action tomorrow. We also are going to have a couple of matches tomorrow. It was scheduled to actually have five. We actually have a delay on one of the matches. So we'll actually only have four. I'm going to bring that up for you. Well, I'm going to bring that up on my side right now. Because there was a match which was actually delayed. So MUFC versus God has been postponed. So we have four matches tomorrow starting at 3 p.m. But the live stream will start at 9 a.m. And that'll be for the qualifiers from the Star Tournament. We will also actually have three matches on Tuesday night and maybe one on Monday night. You can check out the match ticker, of course, for that. Holy Master is the one who's updating that one. He's the guy that organizes all the time scheduling for all of these matches. So you can check it all out from there. Let's give a big shout out to Holy as well. Yes. As of Wednesday, though, I will not be here in the studio. We will be traveling. I will jump in a car, we're going to go across a ferry and head over to Sweden, and we'll be shoutcasting live at DreamHack, which will be awesome. It will be on the official DreamHack stream. We will have that stream available on Join Dota, so you can check that one out. It'll be available through our live streams tab. If you haven't checked that out too, you can check out Link's stream, as well as even Valiant's also streaming out today from the OPSL. So he's trying to reconnect us the call from GD Kotaku, so we'll always wait for him. So you can check all that out. We'll also have Mooseman with us. He'll be taking pictures as well as videos from the event. We'll make those available on the Facebook page, as well as maybe some other ways we can do it, just so we can show you guys what's actually happening at DreamHack. And then after that, we come back from Sweden and head ourselves over to Malaysia for the SMM coverage. I'll be taking care of all of that for you. So we'll have some awesome coverage to come to you from Malaysia. Should be awesome. Well, hello, thank you very much for the pings. He's trying to reconnect. He can't reconnect from console. So we might actually have ourselves a bit of an issue. You can't also stop this match at this point. You can't reload on these games, so GDT will be forced to actually play through. But considering they're 4-1 behind right now with 2 kills on Pepe, 2 kills on Cinderin, it'll be a massively unfair advantage if you actually threw that the other way. Especially the 60? Wow, really? Sea Badger's at 60 for 16, 10 minutes in, as far as farm goes. That's a lot of farm for a Pugna. He was on that middle lane before, and now he's on that bottom lane, just pushing it down. You actually see that last hit in the tower go through. So 461 gold, frozen in time with the tower kill. Yes. And also, at the end of SMM, we'll then be heading over to Ukraine. Currently, the visas are being processed for that, so it should be up and running by the time I get back from Sweden, so I can actually have my passport to get into Malaysia, small detail, and then off to Kiev. And there'll probably be a couple of days of downtime after that point as well. I will let you guys know what is actually happening then, a little bit later when it actually gets 100% confirmed. But for now, yeah, there's going to be a lot of travel, a lot of content, and hopefully you guys will have a great time with us on the way. So in the meantime, we're going to jump ourselves into a bit of a quick pause until we can work out what's going to go on. So we'll be back in just a moment.